And last month, I asked you to send me two people that you would like to hear speak. And so today we have Tom Druitt. Tom is somebody I've known for a few years, and is kind of the quirky person at the Sherlaws, in the Sherlaws community. So if you know Sherlaws, it's full of men in middle-aged white men with ties on who've all run their business the same way and kind of have the same journey, eventually crashing into a bit of a brick wall and saying, I'm so fed up with being well off my feet and not having the business that I want. Tom is cut from a different cloth and has been shone like a bright light at every Sherlaws conference I've ever been to, and is running social enterprise profitably at scale. He's come all the way from Brighton today, so I'm delighted to welcome him. Thank you, Tom.
Thank you, Carrie, and thank you all for having me here today. It's really nice to be
and
here.
Last month, I
it's fun talking social enterprise and business in general, and transport. It's nice to see other transport geeks in the room. So, yeah, I'd like to just tell you my story, really. It's work in progress. It's not a how-to guide. It's not the only way that I think it should have been done. We've made tons of mistakes over the course of the last few years. We're still not doing everything quite right, but we've learned a lot over the period of kind of experimentation. And I'm going to share a few experiences that we've had with you so that you can kind of get what you like from it. I'm hoping to take questions and have a little chat about whatever interests you towards the end. So, if you do have a question specific to the slide that we're on or what we're talking about now, do shout. But if you just have a general question, wait till the end and I'll make sure that there's time for a bit of chat and discussion afterwards. So as Carrie said, I'm Tom. I'm the founder and managing director of The Big Lemon. And we're going to be talking about scaling social enterprise. It doesn't have to be social enterprise, it could be pretty much anything, but specifically working in a purpose-led organization and making it scalable. Now, obviously, we're still a reasonably small business, but we have scaled quite significantly since we started, and I'm looking to, you know, as I said a minute ago, this is part of a journey. We're looking at of scaling further, and yeah, I'll be very interested in your ideas on that afterwards. I thought as an introduction I would show you a video. There we are. Is there
sound? Might catch up.
Might catch up, right. Okay, great. Well, fingers crossed. This gives an introduction to our business, and hopefully we'll kind of get everyone up to speed in 4 minutes. So, slight technical glitch.
That's much better, isn't
it? Aha. Uh-huh. Okay, we'll see what happens to the sound. It was working 10 minutes ago, wasn't it?
It was, yeah. It played it beautifully with my bus.
That's one of our drivers. I can see if I could do the sound. So these are our passengers getting off the bus. Yeah, it's not Shall we? Okay, well, okay, I will talk. I can't remember exactly what I'm saying, but this is Marcus. And he's our one collector. he's now describing what his job is. So he drove this van around Brighton collecting waste oil from pubs. This is one of the landlords from local pub Barley Mow. He's telling us about why the pub wants to recycle oil. And yeah, there's a number of different pickups, and then he drives off to the processing plant. So now Marcus will describe the process. It's quite fun, actually. So Marcus knows the process better than I do. But basically, the oil gets heated, and then a catalyst, sodium hydroxide, is used to start a chemical reaction between the waste cooking oil and methanol. That then creates biodiesel and a waste product, which is used in the cosmetics industry. And Alexis here is describing the environmental benefits of doing this. So obviously CO2 goes into the plants, becomes oil, goes onto chips, and then goes into the bus, and then goes back into the atmosphere and back into the plants. So it's a kind of closed loop. This is James. He's one of our fans at university. This is Emily. They're just telling us why they use the Big Lemon and what the experience is like, what the drivers are like. And we do generally have a reputation for good customer service. And that, I think, is the whole key for what it's all about. The aim at the whole start of this was to develop a service that people wanted to use. So public transport out of choice, not out of necessity. This is Neil. He's a depot manager, washing the buses, fueling the buses, giving Phil the thumbs up so he can go and start work. And this is one of our coaches that we use for private hire. Alexis was our operations director. He's not. He's moved on now for a career in acting. He was so impressed with his skills in the film that he changed career. Marcus is actually a PhD researcher at Sussex University. He's doing some groundbreaking research into really, really tiny particles. And yeah, we're getting near the end. I'm just explaining what the ethos of the company is all about. Basically, to give a good service to passengers so that they enjoy using the bus. So more people use the bus, so less people that don't necessarily need to drive are driving. So the air is clean, the streets are safer, the bus. The drivers have a good time at work, and everything is good. That is the gist.
Well done.
I'm sorry. I'm sorry that there was no sound. So, how do you create social impact and commercial success? This was Carrie's title, and I wouldn't like to say, I don't think success is a binary thing. You're not either successful or not. I think we've been successful at some things and less successful at other things. But I think we have made a social impact amongst the community within which we've worked, and I think that is the proudest thing. That's why we get up and do what we do. But obviously, with social enterprise, you can't do social enterprise unless you make enough money to keep it sustainable. So this is very much about making a business that works. It's not about kind of being a bit fluffy and trying to get as many grants as possible. Fundamentally, you have to be commercially successful to, you know, to a minimum standard of break even, and we haven't managed that every year. It's been very difficult at the very beginning. We've had all sorts of crazy things going on, but fundamentally, you cannot do your vision and your social purpose without the financial sustainability. And obviously, the more money you make, ultimately at the end of the day, the more good you can do with it. So I would say is remember why you're doing it every day. It's very easy to get caught in the kind of, you get into the office and you get 60 emails to go through and 59 of them are kind of problems that you really don't want and the rest is junk marketing. And you know, you kind of get stuck in with that and then it's kind of 4 o'clock and you realize you haven't eaten. And so you go and do that, and then kind of 7 or 8 o'clock in the evening, you think, actually, I've just been running around doing stuff all day, and what's it all for? And, you know, it's really important to kind of cut that out, make sure you have a clear aim every day, make sure that is directly connected with why you set up this thing, or why you're doing this thing, or why you're involved with this thing. In the first place. So for me, first thing was about making an enjoyable experience on the bus. Climate change as well is a big deal, obviously, in society, and that was a big driver for me. What can I do in my community to help in some way towards climate change, dealing with climate change. Now, obviously, it's going to take more than one person in one community. And no, you know, people often say, oh, well, what can I do? You know, but that's not really the point. I think we just all have to do what we can do. And if we can, by doing that, inspire other people to do something or help other people by sharing some experience or finding out something that somebody else might find useful as well. It all kind of adds to the mix and then together we can actually make a difference. Some people do it for children. This is not my child, it's my brother's child, my nephew. I don't want cities to be clogged up and dangerous and smoky and unhealthy and, you know, water levels rising and all that for when Alexander's older. And, you know, the rest of the community, this is not really see that bit very well, but all the kids in local school that we work. So, different reasons for doing what they're doing, but I think the first thing that we should all remember every day is why we're actually doing it. The second thing is to tell a story. I think if you have a story and if your brand stands for something and people kind of know your story, then they're much more likely to want to do business with you. They're much more confident about spending money with you. They kind of know where you're coming from. They might share some of your ideals. And even if they don't, they might respect you for having it. So tell your story. I'm going to tell you a little story about our music festival business, because one of the things that we offer is coaches and music festivals. Pretty much everything we've done, because we do a kind of daily bread and butter with local bus services. And then in order to to kind of complete the picture. Because what we're trying to do, I suppose, is behaviour change, not just for people getting around town, but also to be able to go away for the weekend or to hire a bus to do something rather than 40 people driving there. So most of our services that we offer have arisen from somebody asking us if we can do that. There's not really been, we didn't sit down at the beginning and say, right, we'll do bus services in year one, and in year two we'll add private hire and the music festival coaches and this and that and that. And very early on, we were asked by a local organisation to run, if they could hire a coach. And so, I had no idea how much to charge them. So I didn't really know how much other firms cost or I was a complete novice to the transport industry before I started doing this. Couldn't even drive a bus. So it was a big learning experience. And I just thought, how much it cost for me to run the bus for a mile? What's the fuel? What's our maintenance bill compared to our fuel bill? How much is driver cost? And I had to go back to first principles and work out what it would cost for me to do this trip to Glastonbury. And then, so I had a kind of rough idea. And I thought, how much money do I want to make from it? What's my risk? What happens if it breaks down in Glastonbury? How much can it cost to recover it and get another coach to pick up the people? That potentially could cost over £1,000. So I need to make sure that my, I've got a couple of hundred quid on top of what it costs in order to take that risk. So I worked it out and gave them a price and they were very happy with it. And we filled the coach up and had a great time. I went to Glastonbury as well, they had a spare ticket, so and coach didn't break down, so the profit was in the bank. Wonderful. Next year, we sold the coach to them for 500 or 600 quid or something for the weekend. Each trip there and that. So it's about just over £1,000 for the week. They sold 50 tickets at 40 quid. £2,000. So they've made 900 quid for doing nothing at all apart from selling a few tickets. And we could have filled two or three coaches. So I thought, Glastonbury, two or three other really good ones. I'll just sell tickets on our website and we'll take people. And we'll do the same amount of work, and it'll cost us the same amount of money, but we'll make twice as much. So this was the beginning of our music festival coach business, and now we do about 18 different festivals. A lot of the festivals we still just do off our own back. We sell tickets. Some festivals have now started working with us to encourage on the Shambhala and Boomtown. They're really quite progressive in terms, and they actively try and reduce car journeys to the site. And obviously it makes life easier for them, not having too much car parking need. But they basically pay us the full whack for running the boat, and then they take half that cost in house and sell tickets to punters at half price. I think basically funded by the car parking charges that they charge people to park the car. So it works really well. They have loads and loads of people on their coaches. I think for Boomtown we run 8 coaches this summer. So that's it's nice to see those kind of relationships actually creating quite a significant behaviour change. About 80% of the carbon footprint is in people getting So if we can reduce that by a lot, that makes a big difference. I'll just tell you a quick story about a festival in Sussex called Bakery. This started up about 3 or 4 years ago. And the first time they ran it, of course, nobody knew where it was going to be. So we had a few chats with them. We basically suggested to them that they don't tell anyone where it is. They just tell people where the coach was from. And we did a deal with them so that they could get a very cheap coach ticket on top of their festival ticket. And I think they only sold car parking space to people that, for whatever reason, couldn't use the coach service. And it was a small festival, there were about 600 people there, but about 450 of them came on the coach. And they didn't know where it was. All they were told was to be at Bryant Station at 6:00. And then we just picked them up. And we had comedians on the bus, face painters, musicians. We just basically had a big party. So we do obviously like to try to add value where we can. And obviously, if people have more fun on the coach to the festival than they would have driving there, sitting in traffic and swearing at people, then they're more likely to do that again next time. So obviously, back to kind of the daily mundane stuff. One of the biggest barriers to getting anywhere in, I suppose, any small business, but especially a social enterprise, because you go in with, it's kind of, you're going to change the world and use the most ethical version of everything that you possibly can, and you're going to charge really cheap prices so that lots of people can use our service. But of course, if you're spending over the top on everything, not everything, but on a whole load of things in order to offer the best, and you're charging the minimum you're going to get away with, then it doesn't work. It just doesn't. So you've got to be realistic. You've got to keep control of the costs. One of the things that we struggled with in the first couple of years was exactly that. Having no experience in buses before, things went wrong, things that we thought that could possibly go wrong went wrong. We ended up spending out on this, that, and the other. Driver ran out of fuel, put more fuel in, but didn't work because it was bleeding, engineer wasn't available, recovery, 400 quid, back to the depot, just for silly mistake. Now, obviously, if I'd have had more experience in transport, I would have had a more robust system for making sure people didn't run out of fuel. But I would suppose a bit naive and thought if people were asked to fuel a bit of a ship, then they will. But they only will if they are diligent, motivated, and not necessarily everyone that you meet will do that just because they do not. It was a learning experience. So in keeping control of the costs, a lot of, you do have to do a lot of stuff yourself. So you've probably all got experience of this, but starting a small enterprise of any kind, you end up being the driver, the cleaner, the administrator, the accountant, pretty much everyone. We couldn't afford all sorts of stuff. So I was driving the bus, was sticking signs on lampposts, taking calls at the same time. And I was the health and safety person on the a little bit extreme, but we had this old bus that had been converted to, it wasn't used as a bus anymore, it had been converted into living accommodation, and it was quite nice. I found it, and I thought, I could spend that much on buying it,
And then if I lived in it for like a year, I'd save that much in rent. And I'd actually be about £1,000 better off at the end of the year. So I moved out of where I was, I moved into the bus, and I slept in it through, I think it was the coldest winter that we've had for about 80 years, about 4 or 5 years ago. Slightly extreme, but it was fun. And it did save a significant amount of my outgoing personally, which meant that I didn't have to take wages or something otherwise I'd have to do. And you know, all of these things really do make a big difference. Be different. So obviously, if you're just the same as everyone else with less experience, then why would anyone interest you? One thing that we were, yeah, I think we've done probably quite well over the whole period is just trying to do things differently. And sometimes they've not been successful, obviously. If sometimes there's a reason why everyone else is doing that. But other times there's actually no good reason. And coming into the industry from nowhere, it was quite an uphill struggle to get people onto my way of thinking, because anyone that, if I spoke to other bus drivers or other in the industry, they'd say, no, you can't do that. They'd say, why not? Because it's not done. They'd say, well, why can't it? Oh, it's just not. Everyone else does it. And there's so much of it. I mean, the bus industry isn't the most, or I think it's better now, to be fair. The last 4 or 5 years, a number of innovations and technical advances have been made. However, generally, culturally, the bus industry is a little bit old-fashioned. And there was quite a kind of suspicion about any new way of thinking. And this was surely the problem. This is why services are not always as enjoyable as they could be. Really, this, you know, doing the same thing that you've been doing for the last 20 years is not a sustainable business model. But nevertheless, you know, I came up along this against this problem quite a lot. We've been saying, oh, you can see it's inside the box. Why not? It was art, there was a graffiti exhibition, and somebody said, oh, can we graffiti the buses? Yeah, so it's good art, then let's do it. So we drove around Brighton with a monster riding a bicycle along the side of the bus for about 6 weeks. And, you know, people, if they don't, you know, if the sight of a bright yellow bus driving past them doesn't catch their attention, then a big green monster riding a bike definitely will. For Green Week, a few years ago, we covered the bus in grass, obviously not real grass, and then there was a, I think it was the ashes, was it the ashes or was it? I'm not really a cricket person, but there was a big, important cricket match at the Oval. So in order to raise awareness of Green Week, we parked the big green bus outside the Oval and had a cricket match on the roof. So there was a guy bowling, and I tried and carefully let it happen so that he could catch it. But you know, it was good fun. It raised awareness of Green Week. It got more press attention for us, and I think, you know, we don't have a big advertising budget. We can't employ a PR agency to do a big campaign for 6 months. So you just have to take little opportunities where you can to make a bit of a splash and a bit of a story and get people talking about it and raise awareness of other like-minded organisations at the same time. We drove around London with this bus covered in grass, and we were obviously advertising ourselves, but also and, you know, renewable energy companies, insulation firms, you know, anyone involved in, you know, green tech. And it was a great week. So this is a selection of our little stickers that we've put on the buses. There was a feature in one of the trade magazines about a bit of overwriting. In our marketing with passengers, I do try and just identify silly norms in society and pick at them and try and expose them and make a little joke out of them. So, for example, we've got smile, you're not on camera. Because all these signs everywhere saying smile, you're on camera are just a bit crazy, aren't they? Smile, because we're watching you. So, is a much more logical reason to smile. So this bus runs on waste cooking oil. Some people may not have known that, so it's nice to say. Talk to strangers. So don't talk to strangers, and you know, obviously, you know, if you're free and waiting outside your nursery for a moment, then probably best not to make conversation with a dodgy looking guy that's coming towards you. But generally speaking, you know, you sit on the train, everyone's sitting there looking, you know, peeking over their newspaper. I had a very nice chat with a guy on the train on the way up here, and you know, now we're Twitter buddies. So, and then just silly things like, yeah, this seat is a special seat. Every seat is a special seat. So sit here and be happy. We did move that around, so people can get a variety of seats, which is special seat. Just, you know, for no reason, but put a smile on people's face, make the ride a little bit more fun, and give obviously our brand a little bit of a different feel to what's out there. Communicate, really important, obviously everyone knows this. Properly is something that I've been learning over the last few years. Different people have different ways of getting information. And let's show you this. So this is not the case anymore, but it's an example of what was the case 3 years ago. There you have a full summary of our services for the universities in Brighton and Hove. But are you going to remember that? Are you even going to bother reading past the first two lines? Of course not. It just looks unfamiliar. So communicate in pictures, communicate in ways that people can kind of relate to. If you establish a kind of emotional reaction from a communication, then it's more likely that people are going to remember it. This doesn't have the same level of detail, so you might not know the frequency, the times, etc., etc. But if you're in a hurry and you just want a quick, rough idea of what the bus does, then pretty much tells you what the buses do, the route number of the places that it goes past. It's kind of not specified, but kind of obvious that the bold lines are the kind of standard route and the dotted lines are, you know, coffee or less frequent or something like that. Not quite sure, but you get the main gist. So I think the point basically is that when you communicate, you need to think of your audience, and who, you know, if you're filling out a form for a government agency, then they're not going to be that impressed with just the route map if they ask you for timetable information, etc. Well, it's a bit more boring, like what's on the left. But if you're trying to give a passenger a very quick, rough idea of what your service does, then route map much more useful.
Can I just ask a question? Point to go back.
Yeah.
Are you into the, if I look at Google, for example,
yes,
and I say, how do I get from here to here?
Register for service, you need to give them 8 weeks notice, and in that 8 weeks they can then look at it and try to agree to it and disseminate the information to people like Google and Travelline and make sure that everyone's got up-to-date information. So that's how that works. Yeah. So trust your instincts. Now, I wouldn't say they're always right, but they are quite often right. And I was reading a book about this a little while ago that was basically explaining why your instincts are most often right. Often your instincts are the sum total of all your experience, what people have said to you in various parts of your life. You don't remember all of that, but it's kind of there somewhere. And it shapes the way you feel about the question. And it's not just random. It's, you know, your kind of loop of the whole thing. And it was always a one way. So anyone get And this service basically ended up saving our bacon. So here is the 25 bus was the standard Brighton Hove service up to Sussex University, up to the universities in general. They'd seen us doing our thing, using different fuel, offering a more kind of community-spirited, customer-focused service. And for the first couple of years, they thought it was a big joke and kind of ignored us. The third year, they kind of hit the roof, really, and just suddenly, right, okay, we're going to stop the experiment. It's gone to... And we were suddenly in the middle of the biggest price war that I'd ever thought was possible. Overnight, the fares came down, the frequencies went up. They were throwing everything at that service. They were running buses, sometimes there were three or four in a row, every couple of minutes. They cut the fares to the same as ours, not cheaper, but they matched us on everything, just on that route. And the rest of expensive fare for everyone, and then after a couple of months, that went up to kind of cover the losses that they were, they were having on this service. And we were in big trouble. So I was looking at this, going, frankly, we had a kind of 5% margin and we've lost 20% of our income. That means our kind of is now quite a big loss. We're going to run out of money if we don't do something very quickly. So I went to the University of Brighton, and I said, we've got a problem because the service had just about made the stability, and now the other services are being kind of squashed, and because there's not that, bus services tend to work best when they're kind of a few services that all kind of complement each other. Even if one by itself wouldn't necessarily be profitable, then the combination of two or three to work works. And you're going to lose the bread and butter service of the 42, the 44 that did this Farley Halls run would also hit with that as well. So I went to the university and I said, look, we've got a situation. We're not going to be able to service much longer as things change. Because I know that it's the only service you've got here. And when we started it, they were telling me how useful it was, reducing risk for students that didn't then have to cross the bridge to get to the bus stop, reducing complaints from nearby residents, and giving students a cheaper, more sustainable alternative to bringing their cars on, reducing pressure on car parks, but all kinds of benefits from the university's perspective. And they said, we do actually want to keep this service, so tell us what we need to do to keep it. So I said, well, if you can, if we make a loss in a week, then if you can top up the difference, then we'll carry on running it. So they said, well, we are going to have to send this to the board and the treasurer and vice principal, vice chancellor and people to okay it. How much time have we got? I said, well, we kind of need to know on Friday. Sure enough, they came back on Friday and said, that's going to work. So that's what we did. 6 months later, they said, actually, we'd like to offer all our students free travel, because then we don't need to have car parking on site for students. We're going to develop this halls of residence anyway, and having less car parking would be good for us. It fits with our carbon reduction aims very well, and we want to offer it for free. So how much it cost just to pay the whole bill and let everyone on for nothing? So obviously we told them, and they said, that's wonderful, thank you, and that's what we did. the next year. So it's getting quite busy now because obviously it's free. Can we do, can you do another one? And another one. And at the moment now we're running, depending on the day and the time, anything up to 5 buses for the University of Brighton. And that basically on the back of this crazy idea in the middle of the night to test the water with that service. And then obviously a direct result of the competitive pressure that we were put under on the main, on our main service. So in a way, I'm now looking back, obviously it was pretty horrible at the time, but looking back, thinking, well, actually, that's probably the best thing that happened to us at the time, because now we've got regular income. It's, you know, we can depend on it. We can rely on it, rather. And we're carrying a lot more people because it's a free service. Students are very happy because they don't have to pay. There are fewer cars on the road. First years now don't bring cars to campus at all. And everyone's a winner. So if you come up against that brick wall and life is crap, it might actually turn out to be the best thing that ever happened.
What happened to the competitor?
They're still doing their thing. I think they probably, looking back, they probably see that it was a bit of an own goal, because we were running a small number of buses charging a fare, and now we're running services for free. So we're actually carrying a lot more people now than we were then, which means that their market share was actually reduced. So yeah, I'm sure there's a lesson there somewhere. I don't think it's caused them a massive problem, because the general population of students is still growing. Both universities are expanding. So, you know, there's enough for everyone. That's, I think, the main lesson for us all. So look after your community. Just time check. How much? What is it?
It is nearly 10 past. So
okay,
great. 10 minutes.
Yeah. So, obviously, looking after community is a nice, kind of purposeful, good thing to do. But it's also, you know, it also generates relationships. It establishes your brand as something that people look favourably on. So obviously, it's good for business. It's good for the community, and again, good for everyone. So Fair Share. This is an organisation that takes waste food and distributes it to people who can't afford food. We collected food on the buses for Fair Share, so people would just put whatever donations they wanted into the box, and that then was used for food banks and things. We have a community scheme where in each month, all the buses were free, and people would just donate money into a box instead. And that money we gave to a different local charity or organisation of some kind. And that organisation was chosen by our passengers. This is a recent thing, the Happy Bus. This was a concept just 3 or 4 weeks old, actually. I was in a workshop at a weekend conference, and we had a hypothetical challenge to this has led that workshop, and our challenge was to come up with an idea that we could put in place in 30 days. So we just, about 4 or 5 of us around the table, and for some weird reason we came up with the concept of the Happy Helicopter. And the Happy Helicopter would come in to just extract anyone who was having a bad day and take them off to somewhere nice and do nice things. And then throughout this conversation, I was thinking, well, wait a minute, why? It doesn't have to be. So then, at the end of the session, I thought, well, wait a minute, we could just do this. So Jeremiah is coming back to, he's actually American. He's coming over back to England in a couple of weeks' time, by which point we need to have this happy bus concept up and running. I promised him that we would. So we've got about 2 weeks left to do it. But essentially, the happy bus will, once a month, go to somebody who's having a bad time and take them to somewhere great to have a good time. And every month we'll take people's nominations for their family, friends, loved ones, or colleagues, or just who they think are having a rough ride at the moment. And we'll then, not quite sure how we'll choose it, whether it'll be our decision or whether we'll put a short list out to passengers to decide who becomes the winner of that month's happy bus trip. But that's basically how it's going to work. And we're going to run this in Bronx. So this one was just a story from Brighton a few years ago. Our friends at the other bus company decided that they weren't going to run any buses on New Year's Eve or Christmas Eve. So they thought, well, this is pretty rubbish. The whole city is going to have no transport. Nobody's going to want to drive if they're going to have a few drinks or something. And so our drivers said, yeah, we'll do it. We basically did all the main routes. We had about 2 weeks to put it together, and with six buses or so, just did an hourly service on the main routes in town and advertised it as much as we could. And actually, on New Year's Eve, there were lots of people using it. So all these guys, they were all out having a great time. And we didn't make any money on it because it takes a lot of publicity and everything to do. But I think it got a lot of goodwill, a lot of brand awareness, a lot of relationship building, and all of that stuff is really valuable in the long run. So look after your community and your community will look after you. Systemize everything. I don't really need to say very much about that. The main thing there is just, if it works for one bus, one depot, one office, one branch, that might be great. Stuff is in your head, or if it's basically built around people that know each other and worked a lot with each other for many years, then that one might work wonderfully. But if you add a few more, it might not. So when you're developing the first one, you need to keep an idea of actually how will this work if there are 10 of them, or sorry, 5 of them, or 10 of them, or 15 of them. And obviously your product needs to be consistently good, regardless of which depot it's from or which office it's done in or which of your staff has given that service. So systemize it. Even if you've only got one site, just think, well, how would this work if it was done many times? I don't know how many of you have come across the E-Myth. Really great book. Google it and read it. It talks a lot about this. Oh. Right. So we're almost done, but I think one of the most important things is to manage the energy. Here's Neil, a very happy bus driver. Obviously, if he's smiling and greeting you when you get on the bus, you feel good. If he grunts at you and doesn't look at him, you probably don't feel good. And we take a lot of people to work, a lot of people to lectures. In the morning, if they have a good start to their day, they're going to have a better day. And they're going to think better of service and walk away with a nice spring in their step. It's also, you know, if we can do what we can to make Neil enjoy his time at work, then he's going to obviously give a better service to passengers. Happy passenger. With passengers, you know, we do try and think of something new or something different or something quirky to do. Freshers Week at the university, we said, if you bring 11 on the bus, you get a free ticket. You don't have to give the driver the 11, you can just keep it. The hope being that people would just have it sitting on their desk or in their handbag, or, you know, and people would go, what's that for? And, you know, that would start a conversation. And now pretty much everyone in Brighton, 260,000 people, knows that if you have 11 in Freshers Week, you get a free ride. The 11 party, why not? Just for fun. Barbecue, there's a local band that will play. It's all about generating energy, managing the energy, creating energy, making people feel good. And this is Glastonbury, myself and the other coach driver. Why not have a weekend off? Mixed work and pleasure. And my penultimate little bit of wisdom for you is you. Yeah, I basically have no time for it. I was terribly